Creating gradient outlines and borders in CSS has just become trivial, just as it's already trivial to center things or even animate to hide auto. Find out all about this and more in the next few minutes. Today's sponsor is JavaScript Certification powered by VueSchool. More on how and why you should get your certificate in a bit. First up, we have Jen Simmons showing how to create creative borders using background clip property with the value border area. As Jen explains, and as you probably know yourself, creating an outline button that looks like this, where you have a nice gradient border along with the gradient text, is very difficult in CSS. Well, it was difficult until now because we have just gotten border area value for background clip, which means that you can apply background of an element only to the border. Before I show you how great it is, I have to tell that this is only an experimental feature at the moment, and it's only available in Safari Technology Preview and Safari 18.2. It's not yet ready for production, but you can test it out, and you can even use it as progressive enhancement if you want. I am using Safari Technology Preview here, so I can show you how this works. I will open a CodePen demo that I've prepared. Here I have this outline button, essentially with the orange border and yellow text. I would like to make it more interesting by applying gradient colors instead of solid colors. And thanks to the new background clip border area, I can do exactly that. By default, this is what the page will look like, but as progressive enhancement, I will apply a gradient border here. I will wrap all my code into supports at rule and test for background clip border area. If the browser supports it, then I will apply all of this code here on my link. First, let's uncomment the background image. This is a conic gradient and it doesn't look like much, but I don't want to apply it to the background of the button. I just want to apply it to the border. To do that, I will need to set the border color to transparent because I want the background to come through. It already is coming through, as you can see. And I want to set background clip only to border area. This is newly supported value, only available in Safari Technology Preview at the moment, as I mentioned a little bit earlier. Now, as you clearly see, this is not looking as it should, because we still need to set background origin to border box. Once we do, our conic gradient will look exactly as it should. Now, as I want to have a nice transition here from orange to yellow and not this abrupt jump, I will tweak my gradient and add orange to the end. So now my conic gradient will go from orange to red to yellow and back to orange, and it looks very nice and very interesting. Additionally, if I want to apply linear gradient to my text as well, I can do that, but I will need to set another background clip property and set it to text. Of course, I will need to set my text color to transparent because I want the background to come through. But as you see now, text disappears because I only have one value for my background image while I'm setting two background clip values. Therefore, I will need to either repeat that or add another background image. So let's try this out. First one for the border will be conic gradient, and second one, I can just repeat it like this, or maybe we can tweak it a bit and change it to radial gradient, for example. This is not something that you would use in production. It doesn't look very nice, but to get the idea of how simple it is to create an interesting gradient effect on your borders and on your text using background clip text and background clip border area. If you want to learn more about this, read the article. Jen shares a number of fantastic examples that clearly showcase how powerful this new addition to CSS can be. Today's sponsor is JavaScript Certification powered by VueSchool. Why should you get JavaScript certification? There are a number of benefits, and the most important ones are that you'll be able to clearly demonstrate your JavaScript expertise. If you want to apply for a job role, your resume will stand out because certification not only proves that you can build complex applications, but also validates your expertise and commitment to staying current with the latest technologies. And that is what every employer values and what you should value as well. If you're working in a team, then you should enroll your entire team to certification because this will give you a shared foundation of knowledge and best practices, and your team will be better equipped to deal with complex projects and thus contribute to your company's success. There are four different certifications available and you can find them here. Vue.js certification in partnership with Evan Yu, creator of Vue.js, so you can be certain that this certificate actually stands for something just as well as the other ones. We already looked at the JavaScript certification, and then we have Angular, of course, in partnership with Google Developer Experts. So again, quality, quality, quality. And last one is Nux certification. If you're working with Nux, this is the certification that you should take. Right now, they are running Black Friday, Cyber Monday deals, which means that you can get any certification at half price. Hit the link in the description and jump on this deal right now while you still can, because this offer is only valid for a limited amount of time. Thanks so much to Vue School and JavaScript Certification for sponsoring. Next, Aldi Williams explores how difficult or simple it is to center things in CSS these days. As you already know, centering elements on the page is quite simple these days because we can use align content or justify items on block level elements. So you don't have to use flexbox or grid to center something vertically. You can apply align content center to an element that has display block and it will work as you expect. I'll open the demo I've shown you earlier, and right here on the body, you can see I'm using align content center to center exactly this button on the page. I'm not using flexbox nor grid here. This is straight up display block. And as you can see, it works and you can easily center elements on the page using align content center. But as Oli explains, there is another problem that is not as simple as this one. And that problem is related to text. Text is not only affected by the text size, but also by number of other properties related to text, such as line height. If I just select part of this text here, you'll see clearly how tall this text really is. And now if I want to center it, it will not be perfectly centered because we have this excess of white space due to line height. Oli will tell you that you can use text box trim and text box edge to get rid of that excessive white space, which will allow you to center text perfectly. Of course, read the article if you want to learn more and you will understand exactly how to center text on your pages in your elements perfectly. Next, David Bushell explores if you can mix rem units and pixels. David explores the implication of using rem units for text and pixel units for everything else. And he tested his site on various zoom levels to verify that everything is working as expected. And he outlines a number of benefits that you can get if you mix rem units and pixels. So using rem units for text and pixels for spacing between different elements can be very beneficial because it will give you a little bit more real estate to work with, as the spaces between elements won't be increased when your users zoom in. Let's try zooming in and out on David's page. And as you can see here, I have increased the font size quite a lot, but spacing between the sidebar and this main area has not been increased, which means that we do get a little bit more real estate for main text and also for our sidebar. So this clearly is the upside of mixing pixel and rem units. One potential downside with this approach is that if a user zooms out, then font sizes will decrease in size, but the spacing between various elements will remain the same, which might look a little bit off. As a potential solution to this potential problem, David proposes min function and shows how you could apply it to your elements to work around the problem if something is off when users zoom out. In any case, this is a nice exploration and a nice idea about mixing pixels and rems. Try out different things, try out new approaches, and sometimes they will work, sometimes they might not work, but you will most certainly learn something. Next, we have Emma Sionka and Tanner Kohler explaining everything you need to know about alt text. Alternative text, as you very well know, is essential for accessibility. And in this article, you will learn how to write good alt text and when the alt text is actually required. There might be some instances where alt text is not required, like when image is decorative, and three steps that will help you decide what your alt text should include, because based on the context, alt text can mean different things or should mean different things. For example, this logo image on this page links back to homepage, which means that the alt text should describe this function. In this example, the image is the center of the page, which means that the alt text should describe its components. This is just a simple example that showcases how important it is to identify the intention of the image for you to be able to provide appropriate alternative text. Of course, there is much more nuance to writing good alternative text, so make sure to read this article. It will help you write better alternative text and make your websites more accessible. Lastly, we have a fantastic demo by Bramus van Dam. Bramus created a horizontal accordion that is fully animated using only CSS. This is created using Details Summary element and newly available Details Content pseudo class. And if you noticed, I have moved from Safari Technology Preview to Chrome here because this is not supported in Safari Technology Preview, only in Chrome at the moment. There is a detailed article that explains exactly how this demo was created, and I strongly suggest you read it. But the key thing that is demonstrated here is you can fully animate the detail summary element using CSS because it is implemented using Shadow DOM and it contains slot details content. So you can specifically target contents of the detailed element when it's in the closed state or when it's in the open state. And that gives you the ability to set up transitions and animations. In short, this is how it works. By default, details element is hidden and its content is set to content visibility hidden. But in the open state, the content visibility hidden disappears. And essentially, you can set up transitions for that if you're using transition behavior allow discrete. Exactly what you see here. In that case, content visibility will be flipped from hidden to visible before other transition properties like width in this case, which means that animation can actually happen. That is one part that makes this possible. And another thing that makes this possible is interpolate size property with the value allow keywords, which essentially allows you to transition elements to height auto in this example. If you want to learn more about this, read the article, or if you prefer a visual explanation, I have a video guide exactly on this, how to animate detail summary elements using pure CSS. Even though this is not supported in all browsers, you can again use it as progressive enhancement, because in the browsers where this isn't supported, users will not see animations, but the content will be fully functional, and the browsers that support the experimental features that we're using here will see nice, beautiful transitions like we see in this demo. Thank you so much for your attention. My name is Zoran Jambor. I will see and hear you in a different CSS experimental feature, or rather, in the next progressively enhanced video.